So the next sensor that we are going to talk about is hyperbola. Okay. Again, we'll restrict ourselves only to your school and slightly more than the school. Okay. So first of all, what is the locus definition? Very similar to what we had for an ellipse. So hyperbola is basically nothing but it's a locus of a point or a path traced by a point. Traced by a point moving in a plane in such a way that the ratio of its distance from a fixed point to that from a fixed line is a constant where this constant value is more than one. Okay, so just like what we had in ellipse, it's the ratio again of what distance from a fixed point, which we know is the focus, to that from a fixed line, which we know is the directrix. Okay. And this ratio is what we call as, or this constant is what we call as the eccentricity. And in this case, your eccentricity is more than one. In this case, your eccentricity is more than one. Okay. So let me draw a quick representation of the locus over here. So let's say this is your fixed point S and this is your fixed line. Let's call it as d equal to 0. Now this point P is moving in such a way that this distance divided by this distance. So let's say this is M. So SP by PM is a value which is more than 1, which is more than 1. Okay. So the path traced by this point P will be that of a structure like this. Okay. Which will be called as a one of the arms of the hyperbola. Okay. Remember, maintaining the same ratio, there could be one more set of point and a line such that the same ratio E, which is more than one, right? It could be any number more than one, okay, is maintained. That means in case of a hyperbola, just like we had it in the case of an ellipse, there could be two sets. Right word to use is two sets. So let's say S1 and D1 equal to 0 and S2 and D2 equal to 0. Okay. So if I take a point over here, then this distance S1P divided by this distance, that is PM1, will be the same as S2P divided by PM2. So S1P by PM1 would be same as S2P by PM2, and this ratio will be E only. The same E that you have chosen for that particular hyperbola. There's a lot of difference. I mean, structure-wise, it may look to be the same. In a hyperbola, that ratio is equal. Okay. So, in a parabola, this ratio, Prakul, this distance, let's say I call this point P, this distance is equal to this distance. Okay, so this point P is moving in such a way that it is always maintaining the same distance. Okay, and in no case it can go beyond the line, right? As I told you, this P cannot come on this side, correct? Because if it comes, the distance from the line will be shorter as compared to distance from the point. Okay, so there's a lot of difference, and I think I should actually plot it for you to realize that difference. I'll just show you how different they look. Okay, so let me just take a case. Okay, let's say we have y square is equal to let's say four times x minus 2. Okay, and now I will take a hyperbola x square by 4 minus y square by 1 equal to 1. Okay, I purposely chosen it in such a way that you can actually realize the difference of the two arms. Okay, your hyperbola is more sharper in feature. Okay, it is basically, they are the cases where if you extend the eccentricity to a higher value, they will start coming closer and closer till they become a pair of straight lines. Whereas in the parabola, the nature is quite different. Okay, the nature is quite different. So if you see, this is actually showing you how the arms can look different. But again, it depends upon your A and B value chosen also. Okay, so they may look very similar, but they're actually not. There's a quite of a difference between a parabola structure and one of the arms of a hyperbola. Fine. So your hyperbola can have two arms, one looking like this. Okay. And other is looking like this. Fine. They both extend indefinitely. Right. So the purpose of referring to it, I will just make a diagram and keep it. By the way, the terms that we are going to use is exactly the same as what we use for the case of a ellipse. These are called, okay, let me take it in the next slide. Terminology used for a hyperbola. So what I'm going to do, I'm just going to borrow the figure from this because I've already drawn it here. Let me just shorten it up. Let me erase this. Okay, now, as you all know that, let's say this will be the focus. I'm just assuming a certain point to be focused. By the way, I could have also drawn the focus here. Just a second. Focus for the second conic EQ2. Let's take this as a photograph. Yeah. So these two are the focus or two foci. Okay, so these are called the foci, S1, S2, let's call it. Okay. The directrices will be somewhere, I don't know, I should have drawn the directrices also. Let's check directrices of equation 2. This could have been a better figure. All right, so these are the two foci. As you can see, A and B, these are the two foci, S1, S2. These are your two directrices, D1 equal to 0, D2 equal to 0. Okay, please note that the midpoint of the two foci is called the center of the hyperbola. So this will be the center of the hyperbola. The line which is connecting the two foci and also passing through the center of the hyperbola, that line is basically called as the transverse axis. Transverse axis. Okay. There is no major minor in case of a hyperbola. Okay. Please do not use the terms major and minor for a hyperbola. Major minor is used in case of an ellipse, not for a hyperbola. Okay. The line which is perpendicular to the transverse axis and passing through the center, that line is called as the conjugate axis. Why it is called conjugate axis, we'll learn in some time. Okay. And other things will definitely remain the same. For example, if I connect any two points, okay, this will be called as a chord. Now remember, your chord can also be formed when you connect a point from one branch to other branch. This will also be a chord. Okay. So both are chords only. So this is a chord, this is a chord. Chord need not be connecting two points on the same branch. Okay. So it could connect like this also. Let me tell you, these are not two hyperbola. These are only one hyperbola, two branches of the hyperbola. Fine. Do not get confused. If a chord is passing through the focus, okay, that will be called as a focal chord. So there will be two focal chords. Sorry, there will be multiple focal chords, but you can draw the focal chord here also. Okay. So focal chord. Okay. Other things like double ordinate. So any line which is perpendicular to the transverse axis and perpendicular will be called as a double ordinate. Double ordinate. If a double ordinate happens to pass through the focus, so I'll just draw a small one over here. So, yeah. So these are called your latera recta. These are called your latera recta. Is it fine? Now, few things that you will notice here as different from ellipse is in the case of ellipse, your vertices were farther away from the foci. That means foci was closer to the center as compared to the vertex. Here, vertex is closer to the center as compared to the foci. Okay. Second thing is, again, your directrices were away from the center as compared to the foci. Here, directrices will be closer to the center as compared to the foci. All these subtle changes happen because your E is more than one. We'll see how it happens. We'll try to analyze it through our coordinate geometry fundamentals. So please note down, these are the terms that we normally use. Nothing much of a change here other than the fact that you call the axis connecting the foci as transverse axis and the axis perpendicular to the transverse axis and passing through the center as the conjugate axis. There is no other change other than use of this two particular name of the axes. Okay. Now let's try to talk about the coordinate geometry fundamentals. So we are trying to find out the equation of the standard form of a hyperbola. So let me just draw a quick diagram so that I can use it. Now, this is your transverse axis and this is your conjugate axis. In order to basically find out the equation of a standard form, we will assume that our x-axis is oriented along the transverse axis and our y-axis is oriented along the conjugate axis. Okay. So as a result, what happens? The center becomes the origin. Okay. So just like we did it for the case of an ellipse, we'll assume that the vertices are at a comma 0 and minus a comma 0. Okay. Focus for the time being, we'll take it as c comma 0 and minus c comma 0. Okay. And these points I will take it as minus d comma 0 and d comma 0. Sorry, other way around. D comma 0 and minus d comma 0. Let me name them also so that I can refer to it. This is S1, this is V1, this is N1, this is center, this is N2, this is V2, this is S2. Okay. Now, as discussed in the ellipse, we don't want extra terms like C and D. So I will try to write them in terms of A and E, just like the way I did for the ellipse. Now for that, I will choose this point V1 as my point lying on the hyperbola. So as per the definition of a hyperbola, we know that hyperbola is such a point where the distance of a point from the foci divided by distance of the same point from the directrix. Okay. Distance of the same point from the directrix is equal to the eccentricity. Correct? And this E is actually more than 1 for a hyperbola. Similarly, if I take the point distance from S2 divided by the point's distance from N2, this should also be, so very same point distance from S2 divided by the same point distance from N2, or this directrix should also be, okay. So the first one gives me C minus A, and this distance will be A minus D, is equal to E. Remember, this distance is A minus C. Okay. C minus this distance, which is A. Okay. Divided by distance of the same point from the directrix, which is A minus D. So from here I get C minus A is equal to AE minus DE. From the second equation, similarly, can I say C plus A by A plus D is equal to E? Okay. Remember, the distance of the point. Mahatma Gandhi. Remember, the distance of V1 from C S2 will be nothing but A plus C1 plus C. Okay, A plus C. So which is numerator term. And distance of V1 from N2 will be A plus D. Okay. So from here I will get C plus A is equal to AE plus DE. So from these two equations, let me call them as 1 and 2. If you add them, you will get 2C is equal to 2AE. So C becomes AE. And if you subtract them, that means if you do 2 minus 1, you will get 2A is equal to 2DE. That means D is equal to A by E. So going forward, we will not call it as C. We will actually call it as AE. And you'll see that the same term was also coming for an ellipse. Okay. And going forward, I will not call it as a D. I will call it as a A by E. Okay. As a result, the directrices now will have the equation X equal to A by E and X equal to minus A by E. Now, the reason why directrices are closer to the center is because you are dividing by E, which happens to be a quantity greater than 1. So the whole quantity will become lesser than A. As a result, they are closer to the center as compared to the vertices. In fact, they are closer to the center as compared to the foci, because foci you are multiplying A with E. Are you getting my point? And the opposite was happening in case of an ellipse. Okay. There, if you divide by a quantity which is less than 1, that will become farther away from the center. That's why your directrices were farther away from the center as compared to the foci and or as compared to the vertices. Getting my point? So now, having got these critical points and having got the equation of the directrices, let us find out its equation. So I'll go to the next page. I'll pull this diagram again. Okay, so let's say this was our one of the foci. Okay, and this is the directrix corresponding to it. Let's take a point h comma k. So what is the locus definition of a hyperbola? The locus definition of a hyperbola is the ratio of sp to pm is e. That means sp is e pm. What is sp? Sp is under root of h minus a e the whole square plus k square is equal to e times pm. Now what is pm over here? Pm is nothing but it is going to be h minus a by e mod. Correct? H minus a by e mod. Now you may introduce this e inside like this, and let us square both the sides. So that gives us h minus a the whole square plus k square is equal to e h minus a the whole square. That's nothing but h square plus a square e square minus 2h a e. Similarly here, e square h square minus 2h a e plus a square. These two terms will get cancelled off. Okay. Now let's bring this a square to the other side, and let's bring this h square to the other side, and let's bring k square also to the other side. So you will have e square h square minus 1 minus k square as a square e square minus 1. Let me know if you have any problems till this stage. Correct? Now divide by a square e square minus 1. So let's divide by a square e square minus 1. So when we do that, we'll end up getting it's h square e square minus 1. Thank you, Ritu. Thank you. So when you divide by that, you get h square by a square minus k square by a square e square minus 1 equal to 1. Okay. Let's generalize this by replacing our h with an x and k with a y. So we'll end up getting x square by a square minus y square by a square e square minus 1 equal to 1. Okay. Now for the purpose of convenience, we will write this guy as a b square. Now again, why b square? How are we sure that it's going to be a perfect square? Remember, what did I discuss with you? E was greater than 1. Okay, so e square will also be greater than 1. So e square minus 1 will be positive. So a square e square minus 1 will also be positive, and hence there is no harm in calling this as a b square, right? So here you have an equation in front of you, which is one of the standard forms of the equation of a hyperbola. Now again, please note that there is nothing like a greater than b or b greater than a. In the same situation, you can have a greater than b also, you can have b greater than a situation also. That doesn't change the orientation of the hyperbola. Hyperbola will still be in cis fashion, where your transverse axis will be along the x axis and your conjugate will be along the y axis, even though a is greater than b or b is greater than a. Are you getting my point? Let me quickly show you. Right now you can see on your screen, I have drawn a hyperbola where I have shown a is more than b. Even if I draw b greater than a, orientation is not going to change. Yes, their concavity is getting changed. As you can see, this hyperbola is, you know, slightly more bigger, right? I mean, the arms are slightly more open, but orientation is not changing. Orientation in the sense that your transverse axis is still the x axis. Your conjugate axis is still the y axis, right? So a greater than b, b greater than a doesn't make it, you know, other way around. We'll talk about the other way around also. That is something else, which is not the case here. Okay. Is this fine? Any questions with respect to this? Okay. So few changes that you would see from the equation of an ellipse. In the ellipse, there was a plus sign over here. Actually, there's no difference from the ellipse equation, because in an ellipse, you had 1 minus e square coming up over here, and there was a plus sign. So there's absolutely no difference, other than the fact that how we represent it is slightly different. Here we take b square as a square times e square minus 1. In the other case of the ellipse, we used to take b square as a square 1 minus e square. That's the subtle difference that you will see. And that's why many a times you will realize when we do it in more detail that most of the ellipse nature is being taken by a hyperbola, where you just replace your b square with a minus b square. That's something which we'll talk about when we do the chapter in more detail. As of now, please make a note of this. Here you have to be careful, Prakul. The chances of you making a mistake is very, very high. So Prakul was asking about eccentricity when you are finding for this case. Remember your, I'll just come from the same expression again. So your b square is a square, e square minus 1. So e square minus 1 is b square by a square. So e square is 1 plus b square by a square. And e becomes under root of 1 plus b square by a square. Now here there is a lot of chance that if you do 1 plus a square by b square instead of b square by a square, you will still get an answer which is more than 1, but it will not be your eccentricity of the hyperbola. So the chances of you making a mistake here is, you know, there. In case of an ellipse, there was no chance at all, right? But here you can make a mistake. So here you have to be careful. That's what I can say. Okay. Now coming to the lattice rectum length. Okay, let's talk about lattice rectum length here itself. So I'll just take a lattice rectum here. Okay, so lattice rectum is basically a double ordinate which passes through the foci. So let me take L1 and L2 as the extremities of the lattice rectum. So it'll be minus AE comma something, okay, and AE comma something. Sorry, minus AE comma something. Let's say call this as K. Okay, let's figure out what is K. So I will use the very same equation. I'll use the very same equation. So A minus AE square by A square minus Y square by B square equal to 1. So this will simplify to, Y square by B square is equal to E square minus 1. Now remember, E square minus 1 is B square by A square. So Y square is B to the power 4 by A square. That means Y is plus minus B square by A. So again, you realize the result is the same as what we got for an ellipse. So that's why we say if you know your ellipse formulas properly, even your hyperbola will be taken care of, but with small minor changes. Yes. Okay. So the length of the lattice rectum here would be the distance between your L1 and L2, which is 2b square by a units. Is it fine? Any question with respect to the length of the lattice rectum? Is it fine? Can I move on? Okay, so this is one of the standard forms. And just to recap, in this standard form, the equation is x square by a square. I'll just write it on the other page. So in this standard form, okay, your transverse axis is along the x-axis, conjugate axis is along the y-axis. So orientation of the hyperbola will be like this. Okay. Remember, your foci will be at AE comma 0 minus AE comma 0. Okay. Center is at origin. By the way, let's say I call this as the vertices V1 and V2. This length V1, V2 is called the length of the transverse axis. Okay. Length of the transverse axis here is 2a units. Okay. Now, is there anything called the length of the conjugate axis? But there is no intersection of, there's no intersection of the hyperbola with the conjugate axis. So how can we find the length over here? Now, all of you please pay attention. Why it is called conjugate axis? Let us try to address that concern. See, if you take this hyperbola, okay. Now, you know your A and B are real quantities, right? Because A and B are related to each other by the formula B square is equal to A square, E square minus 1, right? So, E is real, 1 is real, A square is real. So, B is also real, okay? Now, here if you try to find out where does this hyperbola cut the Y axis, that means try putting X as 0. If you try putting X as 0, you will get something very strange. You get something very strange. You get Y square is minus B square, thereby suggesting that square of something is actually a negative quantity. Now, B is definitely positive. So, Y has to be imaginary in this case, which is plus minus BI. Right? So, actually your Y axis has been cut by the hyperbola at imaginary points. And those points are actually BI and minus BI. Since BI and minus BI in the language of complex number are known to be conjugates, that is why this axis is given the name as conjugate axis. But it is not a real cutting because you cannot see it, right? When you're drawing it on a, when you're drawing it on a real Cartesian coordinates, you cannot see this cutting happening. Because if you're seeing that cutting happening, that means those two points are having real coordinates, not imaginary coordinates. In this case, they are cutting which you cannot see. And since you cannot see, we say they're cutting at imaginary points. So which are those points? BI and minus BI. Getting my point? Okay. And that is why the name is given as a conjugate axis to it, because here the hyperbola cuts the axis in two points which are conjugates of each other. Now, for the purpose of just mentioning, we say that this point, let's say B1 is B2, are these two points. So B1, B2 length, which is actually 2B length, is the length of the conjugate axis. But this is hypothetical. Okay. This is hypothetical because you cannot see this length. You cannot see this cutting happening. Okay. So hypothetically, we say that the length of the conjugate axis is 2B units. Is this fine? Make sense? Here only some people feel a slightly, you know, disconnect from it. But here is the instance where you are seeing real coordinate system and you're also talking about a imaginary axis at the same time. Okay. So imaginary axis is being used over here. Fine. All right. Again, I would like to tell you there is nothing like A is more than B or B is more than A. Anything can be more than the other. It doesn't depend on that. It doesn't depend on that. Okay. So with this, I will introduce you to one more standard form. So this is one of the standard forms. Just like in ellipse, we had two standard forms. In hyperbola also, there will be two standard forms. One of them is what you're seeing right now on your screen. Okay. The other standard form is the one where the transverse axis is along the y-axis and conjugate axis is along the x-axis. That means your hyperbola appears to be like this. Okay. Please draw arrows over here. Okay. So this becomes your transverse axis. And this becomes your conjugate axis. Okay. But what we'll do is we'll continue with this nomenclature. We'll call this point as 0B. We'll call this point as 0 minus B. So your vertices are 0B and 0 minus B. Your foci, I will take it as 0BE and 0 minus BE. Okay. And let me show you the directrices also. Let's take this as your directrices. Okay. So directrices is y is equal to b by e and y is equal to minus b by e. Fine. Now for such a case, if you start deriving the equation, you would realize that I'm just saving your time over here. Your equation will look like this: x square by a square minus y square by b square equal to minus 1 will come. Many books will write it as y square by b square minus x square by a square equal to 1. But what I follow, and I'll recommend you to follow, you just follow the same left hand side version as what you followed for the previous, but 1 will now become a minus 1. 1 will now become a minus 1. And here your a square will be b square times e square minus 1. So small changes that you are going to notice over here. So now your a square will be b square times e square minus 1. In other words, e square minus 1 will become a square by b square. So e square will become 1 plus a square by b square. That means your e will become under root of. Okay, so this is what Prakul was asking. So how do we refrain ourselves from choosing a wrong position of a and b? You have to be careful, all I can say. So whenever you realize that in your equation there is a minus 1 appearing when you are writing it like this, it's a case of the, by the way, this is called a conjugate hyperbola. We normally call this as the conjugate hyperbola. Okay, in fact, this hyperbola and the other hyperbola are conjugates of each other. That is what we should call it. Correct. Yeah. Most of the things are basically same as an ellipse. It's just that your b square is getting changed with a minus b square, Pakul. Right? So all your formula that you have seen for an ellipse, the same will hold true. It's just that the b square will get replaced with a minus b square. Okay. Now, a universal formula that I would like you to remember is eccentricity is always 1 plus semi-conjugate axis length. Whole square by semi-transverse axis length. Always. It doesn't depend which case you are dealing with. It's always 1 plus semi-conjugate whole square by semi-transverse whole square. Right? So in this case, your A becomes semi-conjugate. Okay, and B becomes your semi-transverse. Okay, in the previous case, B was semi-conjugate, A was semi-transverse. Okay, another important change that you will see is the length of the lattice rectum. Length of the lattice rectum in this case will become 2A square by B. Again, the universal formula for this also is there. Universal formula for length of the lattice rectum is 2 times semi-conjugate the whole square by semi-transverse value. Okay. Any questions? So just like we had done a comparative study in case of the two standard forms of ellipses, we'll also do the same for the two standard hyperbolae. Let's go on to the next page. Okay. So subtle difference, first of all, in the equation is this equation will have a structure like this. And the conjugate of it will have a structure like this. So where is the difference coming? In the presence of 1 and minus 1. In case of ellipses, the difference was coming in which is more, whether A is more or B is more, right? Here there is no A-B comparison. Here the comparison is whether there is a 1 here or whether there is a minus 1 here. Are you getting my point? Okay. So for such case, your equation, for such hyperbola, your hyperbola will look like this. I'm just drawing a rough diagram. Okay, and these will be your directrices. Okay, for such case, your hyperbola will look like this. Just a rough diagram. Fine. Okay. So where will be the center? Where will be the focus? Where will be the vertices? Let's look into that as well. So let me just name them first. Center, we'll find out, we'll talk about center, we'll talk about vertices, we'll talk about eccentricity, we'll talk about the foci, we'll talk about the equation of the directrices, we'll talk about length of LR, lateral rectum. We'll talk about length of transverse axis, and we'll talk about length of conjugate axis. Okay, so let's do a comparative study quickly. We'll not take much time here. Right, center for both of them will be 0, 0. Center for both of them will be 0, 0. No difference in the center. Okay. Vertices here will be a comma 0 and minus a comma 0. Whereas vertices here will be 0b and 0 minus b. Eccentricity here will be under root of 1 plus b square by a square. Eccentricity here will be under root 1 plus a square by b square. Okay. However, do not forget the standard formula or the universal formula. Foci here will be ae comma 0 and minus ae comma 0. Here the foci will be 0b and 0 minus b. The equation of the directrices here will be x equal to a by e and x equal to minus a by e. Here it will be y equal to b by e and y equal to minus b by e. Length of the lattice rectum here will be 2b square by e. Here it will be 2a square by b. Okay, length of the transverse axis here will be 2a units. This will be 2b and this will be 2b. This will be 2a. Is it fine? Let's quickly take a question. I hope you have copied this down. These are the subtle changes. Okay. Okay, let's take this question first. This is just based on your basic locus definition of the hyperbola. This is a hyperbola whose directrix is at 2x plus y equal to 1. Focus is 1 comma 1. Remember, whenever they mention a directrix and a focus, it is the corresponding directrix. They cannot mention your focus of one and the directrix of the other. Okay, so this focus and these directrix are basically married. Okay. And eccentricity is root 3. Which of the following gives you the equation of the hyperbola? Let's have the poll. 1.5 minutes is good enough? Or 2 minutes max to max? Time starts now. One minute over, I have got one response only. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. What? Okay. 14 of you, 15 of you, in fact, have responded, with most of you going for option B. Okay. So as we discussed with you, the locus of hyperbola is SP should be EPM. Okay. So SP, I'm directly using X and Y. Let's not waste time assuming H and K and then converting it to X and Y. Let's save our time and energy. So this is our SP is equal to E times, which is root 3 times PM. PM will be mod of 2x plus y minus 1 by under root of 5. Okay. Remember, most of you forget this root 5. Okay. So take this root 5 on the other side and square it. Oh, sorry. Okay. Now let's try to collect terms. Here I will get 5x square. But here I will get 4 into 3, 12 x square. Okay. So you'll have 7 x square coming up. Okay. Here I will get 5 y square. Here I will get 3 y square. So I'll get minus 2 y square. I think clearly option number A comes out as the answer, but I'll still continue to solve this. And here I will get 4 x y into 12, which is 12 x y. Okay. X term will be minus 12x. And here X terms minus 12, and here it comes out to be minus 10, right? So it will give you 2x. Minus 2x. Oh. That's where the answer differs. So we should not be in a hurry to conclude. Right? Yeah, so minus 4x and this is 12x and here it is giving you minus 10x. So it's minus 2x. Okay. Y term will be minus 6y and from here I will get, so we'll have 4y. Okay. And this is going to be 210 and this is going to be 3. So minus 7 equal to 0. Which clearly means the answer is none of these. Okay. Of course, B is not correct, but many of you went for D, which was option, which was the right option. Okay. So D is correct in this case. Any questions, anybody? Any questions, any concerns? Okay. Let's move on to the next. Find the foci of this hyperbola. Very simple question. Let's have 45 seconds for this, not more than that. Very good. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, cool. Okay, most of you have gone with option number C. Let's check. So for finding the foci, the first thing is always we need to establish what kind of a hyperbola is this. Okay. So it is the hyperbola where you have the conjugate axis along y-axis and transverse axis along the x-axis. Am I right? Okay. So for such cases, eccentricity is under root of 1 plus b square by a square. right? B square by a square will give you a root 13 by 3, correct? Now foci is at a e comma 0. A is clearly 3, okay? So foci is root 13 comma 0 and minus root 13 comma 0. Option number C is the right option, which most of you have gone with. Absolutely correct. Okay. Now, when it comes to shifted or generalized form, I don't think so I need to discuss anything separately with you, because it follows exactly the same way as what we did for a ellipse and for a parabola as well. So if let's say your center is shifted to, let's say, alpha beta, if your center of a hyperbola is shifted to alpha beta, it will become this, or depends upon whatever is the situation, plus minus one I'm writing. So I'm basically taking care of both the situation in one go. Okay. And whatever you know about that corresponding hyperbola, just do a role change, role play. Role change will help you to get the answer very, very quickly. So I don't think so I need to, you know, separately deal with this concept. We can rather spend time doing some questions. Correct? Let's take a few questions. Okay, let's start with a very simple question. Where do you think is the foci of this hyperbola? Let the poll be on. Let the poll begin. 1.5 minutes is good enough. Last 30 seconds. Okay, Kinshuk. Noted. Five, four, three, two, one. Cool. Okay, A is the most chosen option. So let's check whether A was correct or not. So as you can see here, that capital X is X only. Capital Y is Y minus 2. A is 4, B is 9. Okay, and the presence of a 1, sorry, presence of a 1 over here shows that it's a case where your transverse is along X axis, or transverse is shifted version of the X axis. Okay. So let's try to solve this. So eccentricity is what? So first of all, without eccentricity, we will not be able to find out the foci coordinates. So it's under root of 1 plus b square by a square, which is root 13 by 2. Okay. So foci is x equal to plus minus ae and y equal to 0. So x equal to plus minus ae. Plus minus ae. Oh, my bad. My bad, my bad, my bad. This is going to be 4. Ha. I made a small judgment error. This is going to be 5 by 4. Yeah. So plus minus 5. Okay. And this is nothing but y minus 2 equal to 0. Okay. So your answer is plus 5 comma 2. And minus 5 comma 2, which is obviously option number A. Is it fine? Any questions? All right. Let's take a question where we need to complete a square, if at all we have any. This we have already done. Okay, let's take this question for a change. Vertices of a hyperbola are at 0, 0, 10, 0. One of its foci is at 18, 0. Okay, find the equation of the hyperbola. 1.5 minutes. Time starts now. Okay, last 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one. Cool. Okay. Most of you have gone with option number B. Let's check. So, dear all, I have drawn a rough diagram here. Please do not mistake this to be your x-axis and this to be your y-axis. It may be, but I have not drawn it by that intention. So, I have basically shown you the vertices, which is 0, 0, 10, 0, and I have shown you the one of the foci. So first of all, the center is the midpoint of the vertices. So this has to be 5, 0, right? Center is very important. So center is at 5, 0. This distance is what we call as A. And this distance is what we call as AE. Okay. So A is clearly 5. And AE is clearly 13. Am I right? That means E is 13 by 5. Right now, in this case, if you analyze it from your coordinate geometry point of view, you are basically looking at a hyperbola which is slightly shifted to the right by 5 units. Correct? So it is a standard form which is shifted by 5 units to the right. Correct? Right? So its structure will be somewhat of this nature: x plus minus alpha whole square by a square minus y plus minus beta whole square by b square equal to 1. Correct? Why not minus 1? Because its transverse axis is either on the x axis or parallel to it. Okay. Had the transverse axis been along the y axis or parallel to it, then I would have written a minus 1 over here. Oh, sorry. I wrote a minus 1. It's actually a 1. By mistake, I wrote a minus 1. Okay. Now, in this case, where your hyperbola was basically a case of transverse axis being parallel to the x-axis, or you can say on the x-axis, your b square was a square e square minus 1. So a is nothing but fixed. What about b square? Let's figure it out. So this is 13 square by 25 minus 1. This will come out to be 144. Correct? Center is at 5, 0. So alpha, beta is 5. Alpha is 5 and beta is 0. So your final equation will become x minus 5 the whole square by 25 minus y square by 144 equal to 1, which is clearly option number B. Okay. Now, I will not take a lot of your time. I'll basically cover up two small concepts. One is the concept of focal distance. Focal distances. So if you have a hyperbola, okay, and let's say I take it as a standard case. This is your S1, this is your S2. And there is a point X1, Y1. Okay, what is the distance of this point from the two foci? So what is S1P and what is S2P? Okay, I'll follow the same mechanism as what we did for an ellipse. So let's say I drop a perpendicular on the directrix, which is M1. So S1P is PM1, okay. So what is PM1? PM1, this is nothing but X equal to A by E. So it is nothing but X1 minus A by E. So it gives you EX1 minus A, okay. Similarly, this will be E times PM2. This will be your M2, okay. And this will be X plus A by E. That is nothing but EX1 plus A. Here you will see that the difference of the two focal distances is basically 2a. That means it is another definition or locus definition of a hyperbola, where it says that hyperbola is locus of a point moving in a plane in such a way that the difference of its distances from two fixed points is a constant. By the way, many times in the books they will write the modulus here, because you do not know which is more. Okay, you do not know which is where, whether S2P is more or S1P is more, because if a point is here, S1P will be more, okay, and S2P will be less. So in order to show that this difference is a constant, we normally write a mod, or sometimes in the books you will see they will write S1P difference, S2P is equal to 2A. That's another definition of a hyperbola. Okay, now here also a very important concept that comes out is, if you keep a light source as one of the focus, after hitting the parabolic reflector, it will take a path which, if you extend backwards, will meet at the other focus. I'll repeat. If you keep a light source at one of the foci, after hitting the hyperbolic reflector, it will take a path which, if extended backwards, will meet at the other focus. Just like we had it for the case of a ellipse. Getting my point? Okay. And last thing that I would like to discuss with you is the parametric form. And again, parametric form is not going to be immediately required, but I don't want to waste time when I'm doing it with you in the after your semester exams classes. So parametric form for, let's say I take this standard case. So there are actually two parametric forms that we normally talk about. One is A sec theta. And Y is B tan theta. This is one of the form which is mostly used. In some cases, you will realize that your books are also using this formula. Okay, where theta here is a parameter. Okay, so this is another form, but this is something which is very less seen. Okay, I've seen this to be very less. Many times I've also seen this kind of a formula, A T plus 1 by T. and y is equal to b by 2 t minus 1 by t. So these are different I know parametric forms, but the most commonly one used is this one. Okay. Yes, absolutely. This is your cosh. Okay, pronunciation is cosh. This is shine. Shine. Okay. So this is called hyperbolic functions. Okay. So x equal to a cosh h theta, you can write it. And y is equal to a shine. It's not sine. Sine is different. Shine. Shine. Shh, shh. The pronunciation is shine. Shine. Sine theta. Okay. Anyways. If let's say if your hyperbola is the conjugate version, that means if you have x square by a square minus y square by b square equal to minus 1, we just flip the position. So basically here x will become a tan theta and y will become b sec theta. Okay, so this is the most widely parametric form. Real, why will I joke? Shine and cosh. It's not a mispronunciation. It's the pronunciation that we use for hyperbolic function. Cosh. Shine. It's sounding funny, huh? Okay. Let's do some questions. Let's take this one. I think simple one. Yeah, Prakul, there are so many parametric forms possible. It's up to you. But the ones which are seen in the books are normally a sec theta and a tan theta. Okay. Let's have the poll for this. LR, letter sectum length is 8, eccentricity is 3 by root 5. What could be a possible equation for the hyperbola? C and D are definitely not hyperbola. Actually, these chapters are very, very long. In hyperbola only, we have a concept of rectangular hyperbola and all those things. In fact, I can introduce it to you in one quick shot. And after this problem, probably, let's complete this. Yeah. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. A quite mixed response. A and B have got equal number of votes. However, only 8 of you have participated in this polling. Anyways, so C and D cannot be your answer, right? And as you can see in your options, they're basically talking about this kind of a hyperbola. Okay, so you have to work as per the options, okay? I know there could be two possible hyperbola, but work as per the options. So as per this option, your hyperbola's lattice rectum is 2b square by a. So this is given to you as 8. Eccentricity is given as 3 by root 5. Okay, that means b square is given as 4a. Okay, b square is given as 4a. And e square is nothing but 9 by 5. Now what is e square for such a hyperbola? It is 1 plus b square by a square. Okay, that is 9 by 5. That means b square by a square is equal to 4 by 5. And b square is 4a. Right? So 4a by a square is 4 by 5. That clearly means a is 5. Correct? Yes? So if you see this, it is actually x square by 25 minus y square by 20 equal to 1. And this is a case where your A is 5. So option number A has to be correct. It cannot be B. Don't waste your time finding your B out, because you'll not get a different answer from there. Now, one small thing I would like to talk about is rectangular hyperbola. Just 1 minute of your time I will take. So what is a rectangular hyperbola? It's a hyperbola where your length of the transverse axis is same as the length of the conjugate axis. Okay. In other words, instead of a B, you can write a, instead of this B, you can actually write a square. So it becomes x square minus y square is equal to a square. Okay. Now in school, they don't tell the actual picture. Why it is called a rectangular hyperbola? Does anybody know? Why rectangular hyperbola? Yes. See, we'll do it after the semester exams. In a hyperbola, there are actually asymptotes. Okay, we'll talk about asymptotes. I should not draw it with this. So asymptotes are basically lines which pass through the center and they're tangents to both the arms. Okay, these are called asymptotes. Asymptotes are line which basically touch the curve at infinity. In a rectangular hyperbola, these asymptotes are at 90 degrees to each other. Okay, so when these asymptotes are at 90 degree, A will automatically become equal to B, because this line is actually x by A minus y by B equal to 1. Sorry, y by B equal to 0. And this line is x by A plus y by B equal to 0. So their slopes product is minus 1. Slope here is, you can take the slope to be b by a. Slope here is minus b by a. So since m1, m2 is equal to minus 1, minus b square by a square is minus 1. So a becomes equal to b. Okay. That is why it is called a rectangular hyperbola. But what is important for you is just to know that a is equal to b, and eccentricity for a rectangular hyperbola is root 2. Okay. So with this, we close the school level discussion of conic section. Next class will be on probability. Okay. That is also a very easy chapter. Basically, we have introduction to probability. Thank you. Take care. Bye-bye. Stay safe.